Well, hello there again, my YouTube friends. I'm just doing this, it's sort of a two-part video for you. Firstly, I apologise for not making a video for a long time. As this was going to be my previous video about a month ago, or even a bit more now. But this is my USB microscope camera, which popped a month or so ago. And it's disassembled, so I can show you what the issues were. I'm just going to go over this before I do the other part of my video. Anyway, I was using it and it popped, and I looked inside it, and first thing, I could smell fire, so I knew that wasn't good. Anyway, on checking, I found that this little DC to DC converter here, little black thing there, had a little volcano on him, and he'd failed. So after waiting for a couple of weeks, because that's how long stuff takes to get here normally from China, I got about five of them. I replaced one, put it back in, checked the output from the charger, which was, I think it's 12 volts, 12.2 volts, something like that, and that was fine. Put it back on, and the thing worked for maybe 10 minutes, and then it popped again. So I looked inside. The DC to DC converter hadn't failed this time. Well, sorry, it had failed, but it didn't have a volcano on it. I checked over this PCB on this little chip here, the just above my fingernail there. He had a volcano on him. So that's a power management chip. It's a 32-pin QFN. So after another couple of weeks, I thought, you know, maybe it's just that that's failed, and that's taken the DC to DC converter with it. Anyway, I replaced that and replaced another DC to DC converter. Everything powered up, worked fine for the next session for, I don't know, a couple of hours maybe. Worked fine. Turned it on again the next day and it popped as soon as I turned it on. So that was sort of giving up on this camera then, because I'm assuming that really there's only a couple of inductors, capacitors, resistors all over this thing, a firmware chip, and also the I assume the chip that controls the image sensor. But that chip has had all the data ground off it, all its information, so there's nothing I can do about that. I didn't even bother putting it back together again, but what I did do was pull the power supply apart. This wasn't the power supply that came with the camera. I've just used this one because it was powering something else as well, but I wanted a 2 amp supply just so I could power two things instead of having two power bricks. I just used this because I could use one power brick. So I've stuck this on the scope, and what I'll do is I'll overlay some images for you on the screen and show you some of the power spikes I was getting through this on switch on and switch off. Obviously, you know, you do get sort of transient spikes every so often, or overshoot, undershoot type things with power supplies and things like that. But I'm assuming the timing of these, it was so long, I can't remember it, what the exact timing was now, but it was doing it in, there was all sorts of weird spikes coming out of it, and for, you know, a substantial amount of time, which I assume is what's killed the camera. So I've only kept this for this video, by the way. This will be going in the bin after this. I may tear the transformer down and have a look inside it, because I'm assuming that perhaps there's a you know, a coil that's you know, arcing against, you know, between the low voltage and high voltage side, perhaps, or even the capacitor is failing. But I don't think so. I've tested that and it's okay. And these are supposed to, the Y-rated capacitors are supposed to fail open anyway, supposedly. The opto-isolator looks a bit grotty, but the way these are made, I don't think just a bit of rust or, you know, a bit of corrosion on the terminals would go right inside and cause a problem, I don't think. But anyway, there's something wrong with it. So this will go in the bin, and I'll show you the images on the screen. You might have seen them by now, because I said I was going to do that before, but I'll see where I get to in the editing. And I'll show you the spikes that were coming out of the supply. But as I say, that's what I assume killed that, and unfortunately I've had to buy another one. I bought another camera because buying parts for this one was getting a bit silly, and also if you've got components where the numbers have been scraped off, you've got no chance. So yeah, that was about that. So as I say, I've got a new camera now, and I've put another power supply on, a substantial power supply, which is powering the same, I think it was LED light strips and things like that I was powering it with, but on separate terminals. And it's doing exactly the same job and powering the other camera now just fine. And it's been doing that for, well, since I got the new camera about 3 weeks ago. So yeah, that seems to be all working in order now. So we'll move on now to the second part of the video, and I'll show you this USB charger. Okay, for the second part of this video, I'm just going to do a quick review and look inside of this. I think it's called Juyupu, or a Juyupu 6-port USB charger. Now the reason I'm doing this little review is just because I like the look and design of the thing, but also the way it comes packaged. I got this thing for £2 off eBay. You know, I think they normally go for about £7 or £8. I've seen them actually for more than that, you know, in the teens, but I think generally they're around £7 or £8. But as I say, I got this one for £2. I was surprised at the decent box it came in. You know, it didn't just come in a jiffy bag, or, well, it did come in a jiffy bag, but it didn't come in just some squashed up bubble wrap. And as you can see the box there, it's not just a skinny little bongos one, it's a proper tough box which protects the stuff inside. Comes with its mains power adapter, which is just a normal live neutral power adapter plugged straight into the mains. But the thing itself, let's move this out of the way. I've been in here before, by the way, to take it apart. It's got like a shark skin coating on it. It's not just shiny and, you know, slippy. That's me getting into it, that. But it's got a nice texture to it. As you can see, it's got the 6 ports on the front, or the back, whichever way you look at it. It says it's got iPhone, iPad outputs and things like that. Some of these chargers, they have higher current outputs on certain ports, but I don't think this one has. In fact, we'll put it on the load in a minute and see what we can pull out of the ports. It's supposed to be a 6 amp capability, 30 watt charger. And as I say, its mains plug just goes in there. The way it comes apart, if anyone else wants to get one apart, but there's no reason now because I've done it, you just jam a screwdriver or a spudger in there, straight in like that, and lever it that way, and it just splits the glue all around the case. And I slightly damaged mine there, but I'm not particularly too bothered. But the end just comes off, just like that, once you've split the glue things there. It's got like a clip there, but I thought this may have been a clip, but it's not. It's just like a piece of excess plastic, but you can see whether it's been either glued or high frequency welded or something there. But inside, what did surprise me was the nice layout of the PCB. Now bear in mind that even at the maximum price, these are £6.99 or £7 or something, or £8. But what I think what you get for your £8, even if you do pay the maximum amount, is pretty decent. As you can see, the output, the USB ports are all decent ports. They're not little springy, you know, rubbishy ones that you get in a lot of these things. They're substantial. You could squash these with a pair of pliers and you know, probably get away with it. Some of them, you know, the metal in them's so brittle, you touch them with a pair of pliers to try and get a bit more grip on the USB device and they just crack. But these wouldn't do the proper material. Anyway, the layout is good. It's got proper input protection. We've got not only an NTC thermistor here, but a proper fuse instead of a fusible resistor like a lot of these things tend to use. The power plug is a decent one. transformer, etc., all very well implemented. And also the, I think this is a multi-comp bridge rectifier down here, so they're not using the you know, the cheapest components that you would never be able to get spares for. I've actually looked at a few of these components in here. This is an n-channel MOSFET, and there's two Schottky diodes over here which you can get hold of quite easily, you know, if one pops. And that's another thing on some of these you know, power supplies, chargers and things like that, they use devices in them that if you try and get a spare, you know, the chances of finding one are really remote unless you're going to cross-reference it and get a compatible one. So Yeah, I mean, it's alright, the capacitor's a bit cheapo, but it's called a vent. I actually thought, when I first looked at this, it was the... they may have actually put vent, because that's where the vents are at either end. I'm actually not 100% sure, but I think vent is an actual, you know, a cheapo brand name. Obviously, that's the manufacturer's mark, but maybe vent's a name. I don't think they'd put vent, you know, because there's a vent on each end. I don't think so. Anyway, I could be wrong. But yeah, all the capacitors are 105 degree rated, so that's a good sign. And on the back of the PCB, look how nice it is. I think that's a really nice PCB. A lot of the PCBs you get these days, you know, in devices such as this, the solder looks as though it's been put on a hot shovel and thrown at the board. But not in this case. This is wave soldered. You can tell it's got all little epoxy glue dots underneath the resistors and the transistor there. So yeah, this is all wave soldered, so it's all nicely laid out. And the only thing I would say is, you know, if you were to be super picky, the isolation slots is could go across the board a little bit more here, because the closest parts of the high and low voltage side are actually there, and they've got the isolation slot across the opto isolator, which is, it is correct, but there'd be no problem with just milling out a bit of that board. And also perhaps on this side a little bit more as well, where there's two close proximities of track. But other than that, I think it looks really nice. And also it's not covered in solder flux, which a lot of them are. You know, there's normally residue stuck all over the board, but not in this case. There was one thing I did notice. I don't actually know if I cut the offending piece off, but there was, oh, there it is, there, just there, you can see just there, there's a little bit of it's a component lead that's virtually touching another component lead. I've actually tested that, and there is 5 volts across there, so if that were to short against the case or something like that, it would pop possibly a capacitor or something like that. So I'll cut that off before I put it back together. But yeah, I think you'll agree that it's pretty nicely put together for the cost, you know, bearing in mind the cost. So I'll put this on the DC load now and see what we can pull from it. Okay, so it's actually a different day now, because I've had to leave this video halfway through, but I've put this Joy Yupu back together now. I've re-glued it all together, and I've actually did a test on it the other day, which I've actually lost the footage for, where I plugged 3 USB sockets in here, and, you know, had a look how much I could pull from those 3 sockets. Now, all I'm going to do for this test today, just to show you on the DC load, is how much I can pull from one socket or one output. And to be honest, it's not really that much different. I was under the assumption, wrongly, that this or these top ports may have been higher current ports than the others, because sometimes, I don't know if I mentioned this in the previous part of the video, but you can have a lot of chargers now come with higher capacity ports than the other ports. You know, you'll be able to get 500 milliamps or perhaps an amp out of certain ports, and up to 2.5 amps out of other ports. But it's not the case with this one. You can actually pull, even though these are labelled, you can actually pull as much current virtually as you want up to the 28 watt limit out of any port. So if I just stick this in, say, this port that's not, well, let's move it one down so it's nowhere near any mentioned ports with no names or anything, and I'll switch you guys over to the load now, so you can see what I'm going to pull out of it. And I'll switch it straight up to 1 amp and turn it on, and you can see it's quite happily supplying the 1 amp. I'll turn it up to, say, 2 amps. There's a lot of tablets and things like that, you know, suggest that you use 2 amps to charge, and well, their chargers are 2 amp compatible. So you can pull 2 amps out of that one, and that's not a named port.
I'm getting nearly 10 watts out of it. You can see the voltage is dropping off though. I did notice when I had the three USB sockets plugged in that, I'll show you on this one, the voltage starts dropping off quite rapidly. As you can see, 4.7, 4.6. And as we start getting up to the, you can virtually pull 6 amps. Well, you can pull 6 amps out of every socket. So I'll just switch that over now to the, let's pick the iPhone port. And we'll switch it straight back up to 2.5 amps. And you can see the voltage has dropped. So I'm just gonna see if we'll switch these over again. So 2.5 amps at 4.8 volts. 2.5 amps at 4.8 volts. So it really doesn't matter which socket you plug it into. They're all the same. I'll plug it into that one. Turn it right up. They are, because of the earth side of the ground side is all in series. In the way it's laid out inside. So that's obviously why you can pull as much as you like out of each socket. It drops out at 29 watts, 28 watts, but the voltage is 4.3 now, so I wonder if you can go up a little tad higher. It gets unstable there, which is unsurprising really, 6 amps out of a USB port. Yeah, 29 watts, just under, but as I think I said before, when I pulled the or plugged the three USB sockets in, I was able to get it up to just under 30 watts on that, so you can get a bit more, but that's probably just through to, due to the the extra capacity you can pull from all the ports. But as a USB charger, I would say it's a perfectly acceptable device. Would I buy one? Yes, I would, and I did. Yeah, so it's a perfectly usable device, that. I like it a lot. And I will use this, especially like the, as I mentioned, the shark skin cover, and I think it's really neat. Still got some capacity in the capacitors in there. It should go off in a minute. It's not plugged in. Unless it's got some sort of magic powers as well. No, there it goes. Yeah, so that's the Joyupu 6-port charger, guys. And I hope you enjoyed the video. And I'm sure it won't be as long a time next time before I make the next video. So I will see you again soon. Okay, take care, guys.